Hi there, my name is Kevin Skorupa, and I do the morning weather on Channel 9. If you are up that early in the morning, and I suspect some of you kids are, if you tune on Channel 9, you will see me there, spiky hair and all, delivering you the forecast. And what basically I do is attempt to predict what the weather is going to be that day to let you know if it's going to be a sunny and warm day or if there is a chance of snow. That is my main job, and weather comes with quite a bit of history going all the way back through time. I'm officially a meteorologist, a person who studies weather. That is my job on a daily basis right here at Channel 9. So we're going to go through that history here a little bit. I'm going to show you a lot of different weather pictures, and I'm going to read you my favorite weather story. First of all, I want you to take a look at this here. Besides the fact that it's a chicken, turkey, rooster, what do you think this is, and where do you normally see it? This is one of the world's first weather instruments. Farmers, well before electricity, would actually put these up on their barns. And when they would go out and feed the animals early in the morning, they would look up at what this is called, which is a weather vane. And the animal on the top of it would point in the direction that the wind was blowing. And would give them an indication as to which way the wind was blowing and would tell them what type of weather they might be seeing through that. This was the first beginnings of really getting a handle as to what weather was going to do. So sometimes these days, you'll see these up on the tops of buildings and barns, and they are still there to do that same work. We go a little bit farther in time, and farmers were able to figure out things by looking up at the sky and the different types of clouds. There are three basic types of clouds. This is the first one. This is a puffy cumulus cloud, which looks almost like a big piece of cotton candy or cauliflower up in the sky. And if you watch these really closely, they will change shape right in front of your eyes. And that's because the clouds are building up. They're becoming bigger. And the weather story that I'll read you in a few minutes is more about this particular type of cloud. Most days when you see this cloud out there, it means it's going to be a very nice day. It's just when it's really hot and sticky out in the middle of the summer, these will build much bigger and much taller and create thunderstorms. So this is called a cumulus cloud. The second type of cloud I'm going to show you here is called a cirrus cloud. These are much higher up in the sky. These are higher than birds and planes fly. And again, these are called cirrus clouds. I like to call them the cirrus cloud because the winds up there are blowing over 100 miles an hour. And these are the clouds that move ahead of a storm by one day. So if you see these clouds out there, it usually means the day you're in is going to be very nice, but the next day it might rain or snow. Farmers would see a ring around the sun or the moon, and they would know that if they saw that, that these clouds were up there because the sunlight or the moonlight goes through those clouds and creates that halo around the moon. And it would indicate that it was going to rain or snow the next day. And then obviously a lot of people know these particular types of clouds. These are called stratus clouds. They're the lowest ones in the sky. And besides thunderstorms with those big puffy cumulus clouds, these are the kind of clouds that give you all the other different kinds of precipitation. Rain, snow, fog, drizzle, mist. Yeah, they're the yucky clouds basically, more or less than anything else. And they're called stratus clouds. So we go beyond that and let's go to when we had electricity. Here is a meteorologist here, and he is holding something that you can see here. See this thing right here? It's a very fancy word for it. It's a weather balloon. I know, very fancy, right? Well, meteorologists from across the country, two times a day, in the morning and in the evening, release these weather balloons up into the sky. And as you can imagine, when you fill them up and you let them go, they go up, up, up through the sky. Well, attached to the bottom of this, where the meteorologist is a weather instrument that measures the temperature, the humidity, and the wind as you go up through the sky. So these balloons are released all at the same time across the country, 50 of them, and they record all of that information. And then it gets sent to one big computer down on the ground, and then it creates what I like to call spaghetti on a piece of paper. This is one of about 200 different weather maps that I look at every day to try to figure out the weather. These maps come in from all over the world. They're sometimes right and sometimes wrong. I like to look at my job as a meteorologist as basically a weather detective. I have to look at all of these maps, and they come in from all different places, and they have all different ideas as to what that day and the next day is going to be. And it is up to me to figure out which ones look best and hopefully use the right ones, and which ones probably don't look as good. So it isn't a perfect science that we deal with. We look at maps all day, some of which are right and some of which are wrong. And hopefully we're choosing the right ones. But this is one of four different things that I use to predict the weather. We use the computer maps. We also use what you see on television called satellite pictures, which shows us where the clouds are and where they're going. We also look out the window, which is also very, very important. And then we use this. If you ever see me on TV during thunderstorm situations, sometimes you'll see me standing in front of this on the screen, which looks like a big bunch of green, orange, and yellow blobs. This is what we call radar, and this shows us where it's raining, how heavy it is, how fast it's moving, and if it's changing to ice or snow. It will also tell us if there's ice in the clouds, if there's wind in a thunderstorm, lightning in a thunderstorm, or if that wind is spinning inside that thunderstorm. And it does it the detail about the size of your school from 40 miles away. So it's really good technology, because what you have to imagine is when we're on TV and there's like five thunderstorms in New Hampshire going on at the same time, they're all not gonna have the same things going on. So this allows us to look inside that thunderstorm to see what's really happening. A couple of other weather pictures here for you. There is this one. Sometimes you'll see this in the sky. This makes really loud noises. Yeah, it's lightning. And the sound that it makes is called thunder. We predict a lot of things in weather. We can tell you if it's going to be warm that day or windy or if it's going to snow. But these and where they're going to hit on the ground is not predicted. And we can't tell you when it's going to happen. But you can listen for it. And if you hear the sound of thunder, the most safe thing you can do in that situation is to go inside. I'm going to do a little demonstration here for you. And I want you guys to take your hands, and I want you to rub them together really fast. All right, faster. Now, besides your hands getting tired, what happens when you do that? They get warm, right? The energy that you are using to rub your hands back and forth together makes your hands warm. Well, inside these thunderstorms, there is ice, there is water, and there's dust and particles from the air all rubbing together really fast like your hands. And it builds up a heat energy that has to be released. And it comes toward the ground looking for one of four things. Something really tall, something made of metal, water, or the tallest thing in an open space. And if you think about all four of those things together, it doesn't leave a lot of safe places to be outside. And that is why if you ever hear thunder or see lightning, the best thing you can do is be inside. There's going to be an instance. You're going to be out playing at recess in the schoolyard, and you're going to have the greatest kickball game of all time going on. And all of a sudden, the teachers and you are going to hear a sound of thunder, which is going to sound really far away, almost far enough away that it sounds like your stomach's grumbling because you're hungry. But you're going to have to go inside. And yes, it's a very sad thing when that happens, but you have to understand that the teachers are doing something very important and trying to keep you very safe in that situation. A couple of other things to show you here. I like to call this the weather ice cream cone. This is a tornado. You may have seen this occasionally on television or written somewhere. We don't see a lot of these in New Hampshire. We get maybe one a year. I've worked here at Channel 9 now for 14 years. Yes, I'm old. And I think I've been on TV for three of them. They don't happen often. You're never gonna hear me say partly sunny with a chance of tornadoes this afternoon. That's just not how it works. But these are some of those things that you'll see on television a lot and mentioned occasionally. It is a lot of wind. It is usually with the strongest of thunderstorms. It can pick up cars and knock over trees and do a lot of damage. But again, maybe one a year in New Hampshire. You could live here your entire life in New Hampshire and never see one of these. I just wanted you to see what they look like. They come in all shapes and sizes. They can be as thin as a pencil. They can be a mile wide. Or you can have meteorologists that are incredibly excited to have one in the background. Yes, there are meteorologists out there that actually chase thunderstorms and tornadoes, as crazy as that sounds. A couple of other pictures here to show you. Here's one. What do you think this is? Yeah, this is a snowflake, exactly. Now, they don't fall this big. This is put under a microscope. so that they can see all 100 parts to every snowflake. In the end, you can have millions and millions of snowflakes fall in your backyard to make the magical snowman that you make. But every one of those snowflakes is shaped differently. Kind of like we're all humans, but we all look a little different. Same thing with snowflakes. It's amazing to think that a cloud makes that many snowflakes. All right, just a few more for you here. What do you think this is? Now, you're probably not immediately going to recognize it because you're not supposed to look at it. It'll hurt your eyes, but this is the sun. I want you to notice the outer periphery. This is done through a telescope so they can see all the details of what the sun is doing. Look at the outer edges here. See, it almost looks like fire coming off of it. That is the heat and energy that comes out through the solar system that eventually gets to us that makes for fairly warm days. Here is another really cool picture. What do you think this is, besides a big marble? This is what an astronaut would see if they're up in space looking down at Earth. So you have a bunch of different colors here. What do you think the blue is? It's the ocean or the water, very good. What is the white? There's two answers for this. What do you see that's white when you look up in the sky? Those are the clouds. And if an astronaut's looking down at it, he'll see the clouds moving. Also, what also could be white in this picture, if you look down in certain seasons, is the snow. Sometimes they can see that as well. And finally, the green and the brown that you see here, that is the land. And so when an astronaut's up there looking down at Earth, you can see a bunch of this moving because the Earth is rotating as well. One last picture here to show you. What is this? This is the moon. You know, younger kids would say this is made of cheese, but it is made of rock, and it does go around the Earth, right? There's only one way you see the effect of what the Earth is doing, what the moon is doing. When the moon is up there and it's orbiting Earth, it kind of sloshes the water around in the oceans. Not to the point that you see the waves are done by wind, but when you go out to the beach and you're building that big sand castle and you notice that the water is creeping closer to you, what's called a high or a low tide, that's the effect of the magnet inside the moon, kind of like the magnet inside Earth makes everything fall to the ground. Nice big magnet right inside. So those are all the pictures I have to show you here today, and I have a book to read you. It is called Little Cloud. This is one of my favorite books because, as you remember earlier, we talked about those big puffy clouds and how most of the time it means it's going to be a really nice day, except when it's really hot and sticky out. Well, this shows what a cumulus cloud really does. So this is made by Eric Carle and written by him with a lot of really cool pictures inside. So the clouds slowly drifted across the sky and Little Cloud was trailing right behind. Looks like Little Cloud is smiling. The clouds pushed upward and away, and Little Cloud pushed down towards the trees and the houses. Now the question to you is what is a cloud called that's near the ground? Yeah, it's called fog. Very, very good. The clouds moved out of sight. And Little Cloud gradually got bigger. See him still smiling? So what does Little Cloud do? Little Cloud changed into a sheep. Sheep and clouds sometimes look alike. Then Little Cloud changed into a airplane. Little Cloud liked to watch the planes sometimes go through the clouds. Then Little Cloud changed into a shark. Maybe a baby shark? We won't get started with that. Anyway, Little Cloud liked to watch the sharks down in the ocean swim below. Then Little Cloud changed into two trees. Little Cloud liked how the trees never moved and always stayed in one place. Then Little Cloud changed into a bunny. I had a class last year that called this a bunny dog. So it's up to interpretation. Little Cloud liked to watch how the bunnies would dash across the meadows below. Then Little Cloud changed into a hat because Little Cloud was changing into a clown that needed a hat. After all of that, the other clouds drifted back in and said, Little Cloud, please join us. Little Cloud then started to fade up toward the other clouds. And then they made one big cloud, and what do you think happened? It rained. And that's basically what a cumulus cloud is it can hold a lot of moisture for a while, but eventually it becomes too full, kind of like a sponge on your kitchen sink. And it holds so much water that eventually it lets go of it, and it eventually falls toward the ground. So that is one of my favorite stories. Teachers, if you're out there, Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, the book. A lot of kids this age only know it as a movie. And what's another really good one that I have out there as well? Let's see. Franklin and the Thunderstorm is a good one to describe thunderstorms and the fear of thunderstorms, which is really where I started as a meteorologist. I was terrified being woken up by thunderstorms when I was a kid. So I totally get it if lightning is very loud, very scary, because you don't necessarily know where it's going to happen. So that is a look at some things about weather that we are attempting to predict every day. I thank you very much here for joining me today. I really appreciated your time, and I will likely be seeing all of you when you get to third grade. I visit a lot of third grade classrooms talking a lot more about weather. So we will see you then. Take care.